First, I appreciate the opportunity to be here today. Enjoy it very much. And I guess a lot of it comes down to there are these two attributes that I'd like to think I could bring to the table that some folks think are mutually exclusive. But I think that by the end of my candidacy, and hopefully his time as governor, folks will see are actually pretty darn compatible. I think in the field of Republicans and Democrats, I'm by far the most fiscally responsible person. I've been in executive position. I used to audit cities. I love data. I've made difficult decisions in a position where the next day you get hit in the face because you had to choose between two positive but impossible to do at the same time type priorities. I've been praised by everybody from the Union Leaders editorial page to the Portsmouth Herald's editorial page. At the same time, I think I'm also by far the most progressive in terms of the values I bring to the table and what that means in terms of practical positions. And I actually think that's very New Hampshire, and I think they're very compatible. And so there are certain things that come from that. First, just a little bit about myself so you'll understand where I'm coming from. So I'm a Manchester born and bred native, grew up there. I'm a first generation American. My folks are from Quebec and they came down in the late 60s, Norman Sioux, and they still live in Goffstown. Mom didn't graduate high school, dad didn't go to high school. My mom got her GED and started an electrology business in the basement of the house, classic immigrant story. My dad has been a carpenter for about 40 years, more than that now, and built starter homes. He could do the whole shebang from the foundation to the roof. Hardest working people I know, and we have experienced some pretty difficult times growing up as well, which help instruct how I see why certain policies need to be as they should be. When I was a teenager, I was trying to be the first student to get to college. And if you were around in 1990, the recession of that time was probably worse for most New Hampshireites than the one in the late 2000s, certainly as a home builder. And my dad got stuck with a home he couldn't sell because the banks were all going under. Nobody would finance the purchase. We didn't make any money. We dropped our health insurance, and my mom at 39 years old soon after has a heart attack and has a $40,000 medical bill. You either pay the bill or you file bankruptcy. And so we filed bankruptcy, like a lot of folks in that situation do. And I don't care what Mr. Trump and others say about bankruptcy. It is an incredible blow to your pride, especially when you work really hard, and it puts you in distress economically for years to come. It follows your credit report and everything. So when I hear, for example, that instructs how I look at Medicaid expansion, you know, it's not just a good policy because it brings federal dollars back or because it helps people, theoretically, tens of thousands of people, which is fantastic. But I also think that people that vote against something like that probably did not experience something like I did. And I think if they did, they probably would feel differently about it because they would understand the practical application of it. So I think a governor or any executive is at their best when one of their attributes is the ability to empathize. And I feel like I can empathize. It gives me tremendous pride in the power of immigration as well. And for all the nasty rhetoric about it, we're not great in spite of immigration as a state or a country. We're great because of immigration. And the key to our economic future will actually be immigration, both from out of state and from out of country. Quebec, Syria, I don't care where you're from. If you're willing to work and you're willing to integrate into New Hampshire, please come in. And I think you want a governor that can speak to it in the first person voice. And I think it's a critical part of the future. So there are after I did all that, I eventually got an MPA. And I used to audit cities for a living, city, county, and state government agencies. I enjoyed it. I learned a lot from it. But the travel was tough as we were getting ready to start a family. And we moved back to New Hampshire, to Portsmouth, where we still live. Fast forward a little bit, I was in my late 20s. I had run campaigns for a little while, including I worked for Mark Fernald. I worked for congressional candidates. So I knew politics well, and I knew the policy from having audited cities. I love that stuff. And friends said, you don't know a lot of people in Portsmouth, but you know what you do and you know how you can get elected, so go get it. Stop complaining. I ran. I got elected to council at 29. I was really wonky with some pretty tough medicine at times. At 31, I got elected mayor with about 67% of people voting for me. Fast forward further, and eventually I was a director of corporate relations for UNH. It was a new position, and they saw me as a good fit given a lot of my background. I got to sit with an awful lot of businesses in an explicitly non-political environment over several years. And the biggest challenge we face as a state is the demographic challenge of having very few people, basically my age, I'm 42, and younger. We lack people in their 20s, 30s, and early 40s. You'll hear folks say that the solution to it centers around keeping young people that we have in the state. That is important, but it is not exhaustive. It is not sufficient. The reason I say that is because the peak year for grade school kids in New Hampshire was 2003. It has gone down every year since then. And if you look at this past year's enrollment, it is scheduled to go down every year as far as the enrolled eye can see. We are in the midst of at least a 25-year drop in the number of young people. That's an excellent proxy for demography that we face overall. So we have to import talent. It's not going to be sufficient to keep talent we have. When I talk to this 100-something business, 125 businesses, big, small, new, old, there were four things that kept coming up that were the difference makers that attract the young talent that encourages the private sector to invest and grow. And so the four things, and we can get into the details in the Q&A, the number one thing was pre-K through 12 public education. Any community that has outstanding outcomes in public education wins tiebreakers for young families and the breadwinners in those families. If you don't have that, you are losing tiebreakers. I don't care what else you do right. So there's a lot of specific policies I can get into in a moment, but that's number one. Number two is the heroin and opiate crisis. That is a much more recent phenomenon relative to, say, education or others. But before any of this governor stuff, I've been the chair of our government affairs committee at the Portsmouth Chamber. And I asked last fall what the business community wanted me to focus on, because I thought I'd be doing that the next few years. I didn't think I'd be running for governor at that point. They said housing, affordable housing. They said parking and transportation, which is a big deal on the seacoast. And they said heroin, and they put it in the same category, which was a surprise. So I started to study it, and because we were going to propose a solution that would have a private sector element to help get us where we need to go. And again, in the Q&A, I can get into the details, but I estimate it's about an $8 to $10 million a year price tag in order to address it, which is localized money, which is actually part of the key here. You can put all the money you want above the local level, but there are unique conditions for COAS versus Cheshire versus, say, the Seacoast that require local solutions to some of this. And there's amazing talent on the ground in different parts of the state trying to start and maintain recovery services. They are insufficiently funded, and their funding sources are incredibly unstable, thus an appropriate role for state government. So we'll get to that. The third is infrastructure. It's red list bridges, about 160 of them. The list is growing. It's water. Increasingly, who controls water? The reliability and cleanliness, the potability of water, wastewater, and the bridges and roads themselves. And I would argue an infrastructure of public employees. It's a human infrastructure element. As the state, and you can tell we haven't had a local elected official as a governor in a long time, because they often act like they don't know the real impacts on local and regional government of decisions made at the state level. Just because you balance the budget at the state level does not mean that the challenges went away. It simply means that you slop down who's going to deal with the challenge to the regional and local level. The money's still green, the taxes still need to get paid, or the priorities end up getting ignored. So having somebody who understands what it's like to be on the receiving end of the trickle-down of these decisions is a critical part to reversing what I think are some harmful decisions and are making it harder to attract and keep young families in our state. And infrastructure is a big part of it. The final thing is entrepreneurship. That was the fourth thing. And it may sound ironic that businesses, existing businesses, would want to see new businesses coming to a state. They don't look at it as competition in the long run. They look at it as part of the ecosystem that's necessary in order to attract, cultivate, and retain talent that is at the center of whether or not they're going to make a 20-year investment in the private sector. Before any of this governor conversation several years ago, I met with a gentleman named John Deary, who had written a book called Where the Jobs Are. It dealt with something the Kauffman Foundation had found several years ago. Every economic recovery in the country going back half a century has seen, as a share of the total economy, the amount of new business activity decline. There are a number of reasons for that, but the Kauffman Foundation, and by the way, almost all net new job creation does not come from big businesses. Big businesses make more money by streamlining. They don't come from small businesses. These are both important. They come from new businesses. And what we're finding is it is becoming more difficult for new businesses to start nationally and increasingly in New Hampshire. We know this is where almost all net new job creation eventually comes from. And so if you want to get at bringing jobs into, in this case, New Hampshire, you have to get at the reverse engineer the answer to that question. The problem is the Kauffman Foundation didn't answer the question. They just acknowledged the issue, the problem. Groundbreaking study for what it was, but not sufficient. John Deary and others went around the country for a year and studied, asked hundreds of people, why is this happening? And there were a number of barriers. Some of them are federal, some of them are cultural, And some I think we can do something about at the state level. They cost remarkably little money, but for the people involved, it is a game changer. Because most folks are not making a profit in the first 5 to 7 years. They need to survive the first 5 to 7 years, and then they become the job creator that we all aspire to see. So I can get into the policies on that as well. But eventually it came down to those four things: OPIA, pre-K through 12 public education, infrastructure, pro-entrepreneurship environment. If you do these things really well, that's kind of the reverse engineering answer to the big question of how do you get folks in their 20s, 30s, and early 40s to come to New Hampshire? Because if we don't do that real well, it's going to be very difficult to do the things that we want to do. I didn't hear anybody else in the race talking about that. I also didn't hear people in the race talking about things that I think make me the most progressive candidate. Like my Democratic opponents, I'm 100% pro-choice. I strongly support same-sex marriage, LGBT rights. I have a strong environmentalist streak, but unlike my opponents, there are other places where I'm different. I would legalize marijuana. I'm the only candidate talking about that. I think it actually would produce positive health outcomes. The gateway drug to heroin is prescription opiates. 80% of people who use heroin started on prescribed opiates. It is an explosion. The numbers speak for themselves. I believe that marijuana actually would be something that would take people that are seeking relief from pain, which gets them into prescribed opiates, and take them off into marijuana. We see this in Colorado and Washington and other places. I think also it would generate a significant amount of revenue. I think it would also take pressure off of police. It would take pressure off judicial incarceration at a time when we're looking to maximize outcomes for finite resources. I'm also the only candidate talking about this following statement. If you want priorities, you have to pay for them. It means we need more revenue. And it means I favor reversing the business profits tax cut that we are in the midst of implementing from 8.5 to 7.9%. The businesses I talked to generally did not ask for that. They asked for the four things I mentioned earlier. You can't pay for those things. You cannot. I saw this from all my experience. Public investment breeds private investment. When you make smart, transparent public investments, you encourage private investment. They're looking to see if we are going to think 20 years out. Government thinks 1 and 2 years out. And it makes the private sector very nervous about making 20-year commitments themselves. So when we make the right generational commitments, we see tremendous private investment. Portsmouth is as good an example as any community you will find in America. In fact, we're seen as one of the best small cities in America. We have the most dynamic local economy in the state. We've got a lot to be proud of. We created a virtuous circle where smart public investment led to smart private investment, which led to an increasing tax base, which led to being able to make investments and keep tax increases at or below inflation. Only city that can say that for the last 15 years. So it's a cultural thing. But I oppose the death penalty. So do my opponents. But unlike my opponents, I'm the only one saying that not only do I think the death penalty is wrong going forward, I think that it is wrong for those on death row today. Do I think that Michael Addison deserves to spend the rest of his life in prison and die in prison? Absolutely. What he did was despicable. But I cannot, with a clear conscience, say that the death penalty is wrong. That's the ultimate example of big government, by the way. But then say that in this one case, it is not. That, it turns out, sets me apart. I oppose Northern Pass, which may be not quite as relevant in this part of the state to some, but as somebody with family in Coos County, spent a lot of time up there as a kid, that understands energy issues enough to know that it would be a big negative for New Hampshire with very few net positives. And we can get into that if you want. My opponents will not say what I just said. There are a lot of other things too, but as I saw the field, nobody could talk about fiscal responsibility, budgets, and taxes the way I can. And nobody was quite reflecting the progressive values that I think are not just what I believe are true, but I think are really consistent with where New Hampshire is. Mel Thompson was my governor when I was born. This is not the same state as 1974. And I think that it's okay to have elected officials who can recognize that in their policies and their actions. So that's the there, and I'll take any questions, anything you'd like.
That's right. Okay, so let's jump into the fiscal responsibility candidate part of the discussion.
Yeah.
So you worked for Mark Fernal.
I did.
He was a big income tax supporter. You oppose an income or sales tax. You've got a laundry list of things you think the state should be spending more on. I think the business profits tax cut generating
about it's about 30 million a year in the delta.
Okay. So that's probably not going to get there.
Right.
So what is explain your tax policy and tax cutting or spending cutting plans.
Yeah. So first, in terms of places I begin in terms of additional revenue, the BPT fully implemented is $30 million. I would seek to reverse that. And by the way, Governor Hassan did not favor that either. It's the only way she could get a budget passed with the Republican legislature at that time. So good to put that there. Second, legalization of marijuana. Even among the state, even among advocates in Colorado and Washington, it has exceeded the revenue expectations advocates had for it. To give you an exact number would be somewhat disingenuous right now because there are variables that would affect the number a fair amount. For example, a rate of taxation, for example, on it alone is a significant factor. In addition, some folks would say, legalize it in the same regime that we do liquor right now? Theoretically, there's an infrastructure there already. At the moment, as long as marijuana is classified at the federal level the way it is highly unlikely you could do that legally. And in fact, Colorado, I think, has experienced some of the same challenges. So the good news on that issue, by the way, is we do get to learn a lot from states that are a few years ahead of us. And also, Vermont, Maine, and Massachusetts are likely to legalize it in their own ways within the next few years. I think that if we don't do this, I think that in a few years we'll be seen as behind the curve. I don't think this is a particularly bold position, but I'm the only candidate taking it. I think it would generate, conservatively, tens of millions of dollars a year of additional revenue. And it would actually lower costs in certain places, as I said earlier, including healthcare costs, public safety, judicial system, incarceration system. The third place, and I mentioned infrastructure, is I do support an increase in the gas tax. There are a few reasons for that. One is my experience in all my background is you are much more likely to build credibility and get bipartisan support for increasing revenue if it can be attached to specific outcomes. Government tends to focus on inputs, and that's not an optimal way to think about government. Government should be focused on delivering outcomes. The outcomes that matter most, identify the most efficient way to reach that outcome, identify a reliable funding source to fund that mechanism. See, again, you reverse engineer a lot of it. The amount that you'd increase the gas tax, again, that's a legislative process, but we know that for every penny that we do generate, depending on the fuel efficiency, let's say $1.3 to $2 million, it depends on a lot of factors, that would directly go to infrastructure improvements. We've actually increased the number of red list bridges over the last decade or so. It's around 160 right now. And that's even with us in dealing with road repair. We've done a little better on that. That's due to the gas tax. We have a lot more room to make up on that. So that's another place in terms of road repair that I would favor.
Just to jump off from what Bill was saying about some of your policies in terms of initiatives and the costliness. A lot of the initiatives are kind of pressing, education and opioids, for instance. Yeah. And some of the taxes, like lowering business taxes, are sort of a long-term kind of outlook towards getting businesses in long-term. Is that something, would you give up the tact of cutting business taxes if these revenue sources that you're talking about, like gas and marijuana tax, if they didn't sufficiently fill, sufficiently bring in the revenue to fund the more pressing needs, like opioids?
I want to make sure I understand your question. I did not mean them as an either or. It was inclusive. I didn't mean as a choice. I'm not sure if I said that otherwise.
Sure.
Yeah.
But would you? I mean, do you think that it's prudent to cut taxes at a time when a lot of these initiatives and a lot of these problems haven't really been solved yet, and a lot of the issues in terms of the programs being used to fight them haven't been fully established? And would you change your tax towards cutting some of the taxes in property and business?
I'm telling you, I don't want to cut the business profits tax. I want to bring it back up to 8.5.
Okay.
Oh, right now, I'm sorry, it's been at 8.5 for some time. As part of a budget agreement to get it signed, over a four-year period, they're supposed to get it from 8.5 to 7.9. There's a similar percentage cut with the business enterprise tax. It's a smaller and a different thing. If it doesn't reach certain revenue projections, then they would cancel, I don't know if it's a remainder of the cut or the entire cut. Okay. I'm not looking to cut it. I'm looking to get it back to 8.5.
Okay.
And that is a $30 million a year delta back at the 8.5 figure. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry if I didn't say that right.
No, it's fine.
Do these initiatives depend on your having a Democratic legislature?
This is, I think, another key difference between myself and my two Democratic opponents. I'm going to say no. And I'm going to say that for a few reasons. First of all, on the opiate element, I think that's actually, and maybe the state was later to realizing the magnitude of the problem than would have been ideal. But I do think that we're seeing bipartisan activity on this issue more, especially in an election year, more than you might typically see. I think there are a lot of folks, especially at the local level, regardless of party affiliation, that see this as an issue of tremendous magnitude.
That goes to spending priorities. I think what I was specifically trying to ask is your revenue generating proposal.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay.
Do they depend on there being a Democratic legislature?
I don't. Okay. Certainly on the marijuana, I would say emphatically no. In fact, a Republican House has passed pro-marijuana legalization bills. So look, I'm married to a Republican. Well, I got her to undeclared for this election so she could vote for me. But I've worked with you. If I had known that, I would have run for governor earlier.
Compromises.
folks that know me know that although I take clear positions and I've thought through these things for a long time and the different positions I've held in life, I'm not a bomb thrower. You have to learn to work with people that you don't agree with whenever you have a chance. So that doesn't mean you compromise your principles. But what it does mean is it's hard to demonize people once you get to know them. And until you do, it's rather easy, as we find. So folks that know me, I think, would agree that I look for opportunities to build collaboration among unlikely allies. Because there are a lot of Republicans that agree with me on my sort of civil libertarian bent on a lot of the policies I've just said. And on fiscal policy, I said earlier, the union leader, when I got elected mayor, on multiple occasions on their editorial page, one of the most conservative editorial pages, arguably, in the country, said that I was a model of fiscal responsibility, that I had gotten elected mayor on a platform of demonstrable action, of specific policies and working really hard on them, that said, I'm not somebody that likes to spend money I don't have to spend. I suppose most people would say that. But folks in Portsmouth would say, this is a person that asks really hard questions. I did a lot of work with data. And so departments would ask for increases far above inflation, and I was the person, I'm proud to say it, that was worked really hard, not just to say no, that too often that's sort of Republican Party defines fiscal responsibility often as the less you spend, the better you're doing. That's not what it used to be. Fiscal responsibility used to be you identify priorities and you find efficient ways to fund them, and then you constantly measure them to make sure that you're making smart progress towards the outcomes that matter most. I want to get us back to that. And that is a very bipartisan message. I have a lot of folks on both sides of the aisle that have been supported financially and politically, in part because they trust me to be really smart with their money. And I pretty much trust them with everything else.
So, and on these revenue-generating proposals do you have, would that, in your view, generate enough revenue to allow for continuing enhanced Medicaid coverage?
I do. And let me try to give you.
Or is that a separate thing you got to figure out with the legislature?
Well, let me answer it this way. The one thing that's quickly becoming clear as a candidate is that there is concern among Republicans and Democrats that in order to make Medicaid expansion permanent, which I feel strongly we should, that 5% and eventually 10% of the cost that we'll have to fund. That it may not be tenable under the current arrangement involving hospitals and insurers. That may not be a long-term tenable way to expect us to fund 10% of the cost. If we don't have a reliable source, that undermines the future of making it permanent. So I'm prepared that we'll have to identify revenue to at least pay for part of keeping, if we're going to do it permanently. So I start off with a natural skepticism about the ability to do it indefinitely the way that we're doing it right now. So to give you some price tags, right now I estimate the opiate plan, which has an expansion of recovery services. One of the challenges is when I was talking to folks last fall about recovery centers, I sat down with the one on the Seacoast trying to open, for example, and I walked through an operating budget with them. And we went through a budget, rather. And I said, what do you need to open your doors? It was remarkable to me, it was educational for me, at the end of that process, that it was almost entirely operating money. There were very few capital costs involved with opening a recovery center. The problem is that the model a lot of folks started with was one that relied on philanthropy. Philanthropy is great, and New Hampshire has many wonderful philanthropists, but it focuses on capital cost. When I actually went to some potential philanthropist on behalf to test out messages on behalf of one of them in the midst of this, and what they would say is, the cause is impeccable, but what do you do year two or year three? That's not a good match for philanthropy. There are unreliable funding streams, certainly the private sector or social service agencies. So to me, this is an appropriate role for government, state government in this case, to provide reliable funding streams. In a lot of cases, they would probably, depending on the agency, between a couple hundred thousand and maybe 400,000 a year, that allow them to budget in year to year rather than what's happening right now for a lot of them, which is almost month to month, because they don't have reliable funding streams. That's suboptimal decision making on budgets. So to me, on something that is an extremely high public priority, this is a relatively small amount of money that even in 13 different health regions, depending on what their specific dollar amount is, came out between that, a small amount of money to help strengthen the database, which needs to be used in order to minimize the amount of multiple opiate prescriptions that go on. Small amounts, likely in our biggest cities in Manchester and Nashua, to help buttress on interdiction. And then one thing I have to do more work on is what the cost would be to maintain the newly created 10-county drug court system, which I think is a great part of getting people out of being treated as criminals and more into being treated as a health issue. The ballpark figure on that is about $8 to $10 million a year. On education, there are three specific areas that would make a meaningful difference in targeted ways. One deals with English as second language. I think that in the current formula, generally we underestimate the true cost of, and I'm an ESL kid, I grew up in a French-speaking household, we underestimate the cost to some extent of to a district of a student, an ESL student coming into a district. A second place that I think we underestimate is the true cost and impact on a local government of special ed dollars. The federal government promises 40%, they've never come close to that. And I can tell you, even in a relatively big school district like Portsmouth, I saw as mayor, progressive, wonderful people that when they would see that in a $35 million operating budget for schools, 1,600 kids, that the nine most expensive kids, because of multiple special needs, would be almost $1 million. And they would say, man, it's too bad those resources, if they could be, how much it would do for the other 1,591 kids. And I'd say, wait a second, are we a compassionate society, are we a compassionate society or not? Imagine in a small school district, the impact a handful of kids coming in and out with special needs, tremendous impact. We have a responsibility to do that well, and this is a place where state, if not federal, has to help with that. It makes a big difference in small districts. The third is this 108% cap that you may or may not be familiar with. Consider this. The number one thing we need to do better is to get young families with children to move into New Hampshire, to start a family and to start a business. In communities that do that well, like Windham seems to do that pretty well right now, if you, between modest inflation plus growth that we desire in school population growth because we're shrinking, if you exceed 8% in that, the practical effect is that your per pupil aid from the state goes down because it caps it at 108%. That is an artificial construct. In most districts, it's not going to make a big difference, but it sends the exact opposite message on your budget of what we say as a primary policy objective. All seven candidates talk about this. It's all three things I'm saying are small dollars in a multi-billion dollar state budget, unless it is your district. And so I think, again, if you've been around local government, a difference in a small district of a couple hundred thousand dollars that help absorb the real cost of special ed is one example. The last thing is a school building aid program. We froze it several years ago. I can give you examples of communities where the virtuous circle was almost completed. They made great public investments. Town of Newmarket made great public investments. Attractive, private sector got involved. The mills got redone, Eric Chinberg and those guys did that. new housing starts, very attractive, businesses were interested, and then the school, they need significant capital improvements to the school building. Frozen. They remain there because they're waiting for the school building aid program to begin again. It actually had components that would encourage school districts to collaborate. You know, I mentioned we got a shrinking number of school students. We have more school districts now than we did 15 years ago. We have 20% fewer students, and we have more school districts. So that means that the per pupil cost is going up. We have more school districts per capita than any state in America. We have one of the highest administrative costs per pupil of any state in America. And it's not because they're getting paid big money, and it's not because of fraud, waste, and abuse. It's because the demography has changed, and the districts, the political lines, if you will, don't match that. And so we are becoming less efficient, and it means more dollars are going outside the classroom, and we know from studies the most effective use of education dollars is in the front of the classroom. It's the teacher. I would like to redirect dollars as much as possible, existing dollars, towards building collaboration, getting more efficiency from small districts. We see some of this in this part of the state already. And I'd like to see those dollars encourage them to move towards a higher starting teacher pay, which is the best return on investment in education you can make. Very small dollars, very big difference.
So, but if I could just, I may be being a little dense in following this, but if you're in favor of in continuing enhanced Medicaid expansion.
Sure.
And the state tag, price tag is going to be going up. How are you funding that?
Yeah. So if between, forget the gas tax for a second, because that's dedicated funding. On the other two, my conservative estimate between the other two is $60 million a year, 30 and 30. I think the marijuana may be higher. Okay. What the opiate is 8 to 10 million. What I'm talking about with the schools, the exact amount, but it's a small amount of money. If I was going to make a guess today, it's probably about 10 million a year, but it's targeted 10 million a year in the right places. In terms of the infrastructure, the gas tax is the primary way to sort of accelerate that. And in terms of the entrepreneurship element, it's, again, remarkably small dollars. So I look at it as today, based on current estimates, you're probably dealing with anything from 20 to 35 to $40 million if you go with a $60 million tag that committed to Medicaid expansion. Using revenue numbers that I'm talking about today in terms of enhanced revenue, I'm not talking about surpluses, I'm not talking about other things, that would probably be as high a priority in terms of what you would do with the additional money I'm talking about today.
So you talked about small dollars, and you talked about the opioid, and your plan is 8 to 10 million, but you haven't actually talked about the enforcement side of the opioid crisis, and I just wanted to know what your thoughts were in the last few weeks on the Granite Hammer operation, and how that fits in with how you think that this opioid crisis should be addressed, and how you would split funding between treatment and enforcement.
My concern about Granite Hammer in general is that it overemphasizes, it treats the issue more as a criminal issue, when I think it's really more of a healthcare recovery issue. And that in the long run, if we're going to deal with this effectively, I need to make sure resources are moving much more towards prevention. So that's not starting the opiate addiction, that's where it begins. And an effective recovery. In certain communities, are additional law enforcement resources needed? They are. Manchester probably as much as any community in the state. But my biggest concern with it is I want to make sure that resources are not disproportionately going to interdiction. I'd like to see them going more towards preventing folks from getting down this train, going down this path, and effective recovery so that we're not getting into relapse situations. And I fear that it may be going further into interdiction than it is towards prevention and recovery.
And do you think the other policies that you'd like to prioritize, do they have a higher chance of getting more bipartisan support to pass? Or do you think that's likely?
About the opiate crisis?
Do you think the treatment, do you think there'd be a bit of more of an uphill climb to get those passed, and how would you get around that sort of opposition?
Yeah. You mean relative to an enforcement heavy
right.
message?
Yeah. But, yeah. that the one side does seem to have a lot more support from both sides.
It's yeah, well, look, it's politically very easy to say I'm going to be tough on crime. That's you can tell it's an election year. I don't know anybody that doesn't want to be tough on crime. But if we're serious about reversing the trend, I believe how you run says something about how you'll govern. And so I'm trying to be clearer and specific on a lot of policies so that if and when you win, you have more of a mandate to say, look, I communicated clearly where I want to go as a state. It's based on a lot of data. It's based on sitting down with experts on these various issues. And so it gives a kind of a confidence when you get in, because you got to get the title. That's the whole point. So I want the job.
So you would commit then by that, based on your campaigning, you would commit to less of an enforcement heavy approach as soon as you came into office.
That my priority is recovery and prevention. There's some enforcement. I mean, there's some, you got to interdict. I mean, there's an interdiction component, but I mean, frankly, even the name, Granite Hammer, it suggests a very strong emphasis on the law enforcement element. I'm not saying you have to pick, but I'm saying if you're going to prioritize, wouldn't we prioritize prevention and recovery? That's how we get out of the link, right? Ultimately, that's how we get out of the cycle that we're in right now. So I do want to change the culture of this, and the funding has to reflect that change in culture.
One aspect of Granite Hammer and also enforcement in general is that it's a lot easier to pin down in terms of costs because you're dealing with police departments that, you know, they know how much these procedures are going to cost, they know how much staffing will be. A lot of these other things, drug courts, treatment centers, there's a lot more unknown. So when you're balancing the budget, especially when you have so many moving parts, as we've talked about earlier, with sources of revenue, how are you going to, do you think that there's a risk that some of these treatment efforts will kind of balloon out of control, and what would you do to address that?
Yeah.
And also, given that the airport crisis is arguably the most important crisis facing New Hampshire right now, would you put other programs that you've listed, for instance, school development, infrastructure, would you put those on hold? Which would you prioritize?
Yeah.
That's a multi-part question.
No. Well, I'll start at the end. I mentioned four priorities, at least four. They're all really important, but if somebody said you've got finite resources, I mean, I used to be a mayor who had to make choices, so I'll make them. To me, the education and opioid are at a tier that is higher, certainly in the near term, than the other two, although I think they're all important. I also think in terms of the opioid and heroin crisis, it is a relative to the cost of the, it's a small amount of money if you do it right to make an awfully big difference. I think the value proposition in terms of lives, how do I value how much we, and saving a life, the value proposition is immense.
So you would probably just continue, if it turned out that the costs ran higher than you thought, you would, by that we just said, you would continue funding, putting into whatever it needed?
Well, if I don't do anything else right, playing a meaningful role in reversing the opiate crisis, it's a pretty good starting point for a successful administration. That's one. So yeah, that's the starting point. And the second thing I'd say is, I think unlike my opponents, I think I've spent more time in a non-political environment. It's really hard to keep learning when you're in the middle of a campaign because you're getting hit with all kinds of day-to-day, tactical and political. You try to keep learning, but it gets much harder. I had the benefit, unlike most of my opponents, of many months in the last couple of years where I wasn't in office, I wasn't thinking about running for office, I was in positions where I could learn a lot without those constraints. And this includes the opiate. So when I feel confident about that dollar amount, it is not a number that I feel is very pie in the sky. It is based on talking to sergeants who dealt with interdiction. It's dealing with people on the prescription side of it. It's especially dealing with people trying to start recovery centers. So I feel like it's grounded in reality. It's grounded in the expertise of people that are trying to make it happen and in the numbers that they gave me.
Okay. Another related topic, only because it deals with drugs. Since legalization and regulation of marijuana is one of your key revenue generators. You say that you do not think that would increase the use of marijuana among young people, and you don't feel that it poses a health risk. You know, we have local substance abuse experts who would disagree on both of those stands. don't you think if Colorado and Washington are in year two of legalization, isn't it a bit soon to be coming to conclusions on what the long-term public health effects of that are going
to
be?
Well, a few things. First is, and I don't claim to be an expert on day one. It's not my background, so I have to rely on what I read and talking to other folks as well. And I guess I'd reclassify what you said. I think that there are many folks, including in the healthcare community, including in law enforcement, who would take my side on the debate. So I acknowledge that there is a debate. But I think it's not a one-sided debate, and I fall on the side of those who, looking at the evidence, suggest that holistically the benefits are far outweigh any drawbacks. I would also say this is a state that for a long time has been taxing tobacco and controlling liquor, and I think it's a difficult argument for any of my opponents to make to say that we can't legalize marijuana because it's just not right. But my two opponents have both said in the last week that they're open to increasing the tobacco tax, not as a means of lowering smoking, but as a means of increasing revenue, which I oppose. In fact, if you did increase tobacco taxes, I presume it would be in the name of hopefully reducing smoking. To do it as a revenue source, I find that I would not do that. And because there are no health benefits to smoking tobacco, I mean, none. We know it kills people. And alcohol, I would say marijuana legalization resembles much more closely alcohol than it does cigarettes for a number of reasons. But again, I think one of the key health benefits is at a time when prescribed opiates are the gateway to heroin. This is something that I think will actually lessen opiate use. That's an important benefit. And we're also talking about, you know, whether it's medical marijuana, decriminalization. We see a lot of conversation going on that sort of gets on the edges of it. And I think this is actually one place where there's a lot of bipartisan consensus. I think this is something we could get done in year one.
Well, at least as far as the addressing the opiate situation, people getting on painkillers, and if they have marijuana, then maybe they'd be less likely to do it, which I take it as your argument. Isn't that what medical marijuana that's already been enacted meant to address?
Oh, yes.
So that doesn't become a reason to further expand it.
Well, no, although I will say that I think that there continues to be debate about that. I mean, I guess part of this is, I don't take as a given, depending on the composition of the legislature, that if given the opportunity, they would not seek to repeal that. I mean, I think some of it also deals with the cost of incarceration, the judicial system, law enforcement, the fact that you have a permanent criminal record for using marijuana. That strikes me as odd. And it does have the effect of generating revenue, which is not the reason you do it, but it's not insignificant.
So one of the programs that actually we haven't talked about yet is, and one of the issues also is mental health treatment. So with budgetary cuts, it's becoming, there's longer waiting lists and, you know, there's people waiting for care. Do you have specific policies to for mental health treatment and for programs of that sort, and how are those going to be funded?
Yeah, as I continue to learn, you know, one thing I'd say is you can only be an expert on a couple of things when you're seeking higher office, and on everything else you have to have a humility that says I need to learn from those that are experts. So I start with that on a lot of topics. My growing knowledge on this is that one of the places we have to start on this topic is the way that dollars are allocated. Something I'm learning a lot about is lapsed dollars, that money can be held in a position as somebody that it would be normally allocated for them, but for a variety of reasons they may not get those dollars in a given year. One example somebody gave me the other day is if somebody is getting ongoing treatment and then they leave, say, for a period of time to go to Florida, this is the exact example somebody gave, for a month. There would be a month of the resources available to that person that would be held because they wouldn't be used during that time. At the end of the year, that money ends up being considered lapsed dollars and ends up typically in the next year's budget. They reduce the budget. They look at lapsed dollars as money they didn't need after all. And so it ends up having the effect, unwittingly, of reducing the total number of dollars over time because of that. At the same time, if other folks come into the system of need in need of services, they cannot access lapsed dollars that would be allocated for the specific person, in my example. And so they'll often have to wait until it's approved in a world of finite dollars. So now you're losing time, as well as we're acting as if these dollars don't exist. There are ways in talking to people that frankly know a lot more about it than I do, to be able to, at least as a quick starting point, to be able to streamline that process, both to get dollars to people sooner when they seek to enter the system, as well as to avoid this dynamic where the lapsed dollar then gets treated as excess dollars that weren't needed, when I think it's pretty clear that that's not the dynamic that's in play.
That may be one way in which budgets are reduced through lapsed dollars, but another is simply the legislature saying we're not funding DHHS at the level that is requested. And that has happened over and over again, which is one of the reasons that mental health services are going wanting. But so that also speaks to the state's kind of patchwork approach to revenue generation. And it sounds like you have a couple more patches to add to that. Given your background, having worked on Mark Fernald's campaign, I would have expected maybe you would be more open to an income tax, sales tax. Can you explain why you don't think right?
And I worked for a lot of candidates early in my career, too, and I think very highly of Mark, so I start with that. First, the sales tax, which I think is an easier explanation. I think the sales taxes are generally regressive. There are things you can do to mitigate that a little bit. They're generally regressive. And the second is, for better or worse, we have built an economy, pardon me, in certain parts of the state, including the Sea Coast, Nashua, other places, where we're built on the sales tax advantage. So, there's one. In terms of the income tax, there's a few things. One is, there have been a handful of states that have implemented a state income tax in the last several decades. Two of them are Connecticut and New Jersey. In both cases, they did it, understandably, in the name of injecting fairness and probably additional revenue, I suspect, as part of the conversation as well, in reducing property taxes, which I think even opponents of income tax will agree are not tied as closely to ability to pay as, say, an income tax or a lot of even some other things. But in both cases, what you find is over a period of time, you put in the income tax and the property tax remains, floats pretty quickly back to a level that made it one of the highest in the country, as New Jersey and Connecticut both are right now. And then you have an income tax on top of it. So one of the screens I use in trying to identify the practical impact of public policy decisions, one of several, is what I call my Norman Sue test. Those are my folks that I described when I first started, began today. My dad's 71, my mom is 64. They're still paying a mortgage. My dad's hoping to retire at the end of this year. My mom has some health issues, she doesn't work. They make modest money. They're very typical, I think, of a lot of people. They pay their property tax, but I think that what would happen in the near future is if we had an income tax, they would pay, it would be a modest income tax for them, because there probably would be some personal exemptions and all. But I think the net effect would be within a few years, they'd be paying the same or more, probably more taxes net as they're paying now. So I don't know that it helps them very much. And the solutions that I'm looking at, or what I'm discussing today, are not at the size that I think that in the environment I think an income tax would eventually take up, would generate a lot more revenue than what I'm talking about today. So there's a number of reasons why I don't support it, but I mean, I've told folks, and I don't want to be cute about it, I'm not taking the pledge. And the reason I'm not taking the pledge is because it's part of changing what is a 40 plus year dynamic. I was born when Mel Thompson was governor and in Manchester, and the state looks a lot different than it did then politically and in other ways. And nobody asks any candidate to take a pledge on any other issue. When I say I'm against casino gambling, nobody asks me to take a pledge because they believe me. They believe me. When I say I'm pro-choice, they don't ask me to take a pledge. Nobody does. But on one issue, they ask you to take a pledge, and it creates a sort of political environment where even the fact that I say that we need additional revenue sets me apart from my other two Democratic candidates. And while I don't support an income tax, or sales tax, it says something that it is counted as provocative that I say that we need additional net revenue, which it does compared to my Democratic opponents. So if you're going to begin to have a culture where we're going to be a little more candid about spending, taxes, prioritization, how much it costs to do them, not only do you have to begin by saying what I'm telling you today, it also needs to be somebody who has a background in auditing cities, is somebody who people know as a data-driven mayor, somebody that was praised by people in the center-right and center-left on budgets and taxes, so that you know that I'm trying to be honest about this and look at the math, and if there are things that are really big priorities, I'm not going to let Medicaid expand. You know, if the state has to come up with dollars to fund the permanent Medicaid expansion, I'm not going to let that wither in the vine. I grew up in a house where if we had had Medicaid expansion, we would have been a hell of a lot better off than we ended up being. I get the importance of these policies. We should be an empathetic, compassionate society. And the values in our budget, at the end, that's the true reflection of our level of compassion for those that are least among us. So that's the values that I bring to the table on that. And I hope that's helpful as people are seeing, you know, what I do as governor.
To that end, regarding revenue sources and economic stimulation, you mentioned before that New Hampshire has a very high median age, I think third highest in the country. And so your solution is, as you mentioned before, is to lure back people from outside the state or lure into the state through education, through improving schools, without going down a circular chicken or egg thing.
Yep.
In terms of funding and how everything gets plugged, how specifically would you improve the schools in order to attract that share of demographic, and how do you see that playing out particularly?
All right, because I already went into the detail on certain elements where targeted additional funding could make a difference. But what the macro is, it comes back to educational outcomes. When you start with what are the elements that deliver the highest educational outcomes in America, Massachusetts is generally seen as number one in the country in educational outcomes, though you can use different outcomes. But consider this. The average student's educational outcomes in Massachusetts are about the same as the average Canadian student. So when I say that my goal is to provide the best educational outcomes in America in pre-K through 12 public education, I'm not even suggesting that we're going to be the global best. I think some people think that sounds like a highfalutin goal. We're in the top 10 by most measures already. But here's my thing. We start off in the top 10 when we wake up in the morning. We have some of the highest college graduation rates in terms of our adults that are here of any state in the country. We have the lowest poverty rate of any state in the country. We have one of the highest median incomes of any state in the country. Shame on us if we don't start in the top 10 in education, because we have a disproportionate share of households that, when they do have a kid that goes in the school system, start off in a far more advantageous place than many other states in the country would ever dream of. So for me, we're not trying to get from number 30 to number one. We're trying to get from, depending on how you measure it, number 7, 6 to number 1. Part of this is because it's better outcomes. Frankly, part of it, and it's policy, part of it is the branding of the state. I want to see over a period of years the ability to brand the state authentically through data, through results, as the best place to deliver public education, as a place that has reversed the trend line in opiate and heroin abuse, that has moved forward on infrastructure. So instead of growing the list, we're bringing it back. And again, the businesses are the ones that are asking for this, and that are highly entrepreneur friendly for people that want to start a business in New Hampshire. And there are metrics for those things.
The metrics would be interesting. Because you've talked about this as a tiebreaker aspect.
Yes.
At education, you've used that phrase a lot. When it comes to getting businesses to come in as well, not just improving the demographics, but also improving the business side. At what point, you just mentioned branding, what point is the New Hampshire education system, if you're seeking to continue to go up, what point is there going to be that watershed moment when, as you say, these tiebreaker situations will turn in New Hampshire's favor?
Well, we know it's already happening in selected communities. I'm going to be a little biased in Portsmouth, okay? My younger daughter just finished fifth grade about a week ago at Dondero Elementary School. Dondero, 12, 13 years ago, was on that No Child Left Behind list, and then there were parents leaving the school to go to one of the other elementary schools in Portsmouth. It was, by Portsmouth standards, a panicky situation. It was ranked last year as the 8th highest performing elementary school in New Hampshire, the same school, the one that my daughter's in. That was the lowest performing of the three, the lowest. Little Harbor Elementary School was ranked number three earlier this year, last year rather, by an education publication, number three in the country. Look at the performance in the communities that are already seen to have high performing public education systems. They are also generally the most dynamic, some of the most dynamic local economies in the state. So we already see the results in those communities that have it. Let me flip it around to a community that's struggling a little bit. And I say this with respect. Rochester, Albany International, a lot of folks have championed over the last 5 years, is a great example of New Hampshire kind of collaborating and not throwing a $500 million tax credit like maybe South Carolina would for a car plant, because that's not our mode. That's not how we do it. And they came up with a package, Albany International, hundreds of net new jobs created, and there are going to be another 1,000+ jobs in terms of suppliers in that part of the state as well. I talked to engineers, that relatively young engineers that took the job while I was at UNH, and I would ask them about their thought process. And I would talk to people who worked at Albany, and they would say that you would have all these advantages, great company, and it is, advancement opportunity, pay, you're near the ocean, you're near the mountains, it's great, a lot of things, low house prices. But the reputation, fair or not, of the school district in Rochester was such that a lot of the spouses of the prospective employee would say, hey, I did the research on the school. It's not where I'd want it to be. And as a dad of two kids, I know that when your kids are in a great school, a lot of other stress is going to happen in life, but you feel really good about that part of your life. And if it's the opposite, I don't care how good the other part of your life is going, it is a big concern when you got kids. And they say, you can't take the job. All these advantages get crossed out by this one disadvantage, either because my kid won't be in the school that I want them to be in, or because I'm going to have to spend my raise on a private education. And so now you've taken the economic argument away a little bit. So why did these engineers take the jobs, right? Because I talked to some that did. And they said that what they did, a number of them, did additional research to find other school districts nearby, particularly elementary school districts, that did satisfy them. The town of Stratford, little town, I guess it's a K-5 school district. There were a growing number of young engineers and their families that were living there. The reason is because of the quality of the schools that they saw in that community. We're not far from there. That's the thing. There are parts of the state, it's not even. But we're not that far from there. You know, this is not a 40th in the country kind of thing.
We've come a ways, since the issue of county by county, school systems in the late 90s kind of came to a head and the disparities there. So you're talking about raising, and you're talking about the very real effects of having different schoolers, different areas of New Hampshire, have different sets of standards and meeting different sets of standards. So how would you in the governor's office seek to raise all ships when you get in?
One thing is, and it's something that we used to do a lot more often in public policy in different areas, is to provide carrots to encourage collaboration between school districts. When other states and education consultants around the country, and some of whom I've talked to periodically going back to when I worked for Mark, they would say when we look at how public education was structured in America in the 19th century, we come to New Hampshire today. And the reason for that in part is because of what I said earlier. The good news in New Hampshire is we spend good money on public education, and that's a great thing. It's, as I've indicated today, it's the single most important public policy priority. If we do that well, a lot of other costs go down over time. The outcomes are tremendous, and we are willing to spend money on it. It is the majority of almost every local operating budget in the state. The challenge is that as demography changed, the number of kids have shrunk, school-age kids, we've increased the number of school districts, we end up spending more per pupil, but it doesn't attach to outcomes. It's becoming inefficient. And so, for example, the school building aid program that's been frozen, one of the elements is that you would get a bonus reimbursement if you could bring in other schools, often elementary schools, into the middle or up to the high school. That was a carrot that encouraged collaboration and saves a tremendous amount of money. There are two towns near me in Portsmouth, Newcastle and Newington. Both of them often have classes, and I mean grades, not classrooms, entire grades, with single-digit numbers of students in them. My number may be off by a little, but it won't be much. Newcastle's average per pupil spending is north of $28,000 this year. Newington's per pupil spending is north of $32,000 this year. If you add all the spending we take in terms of federal, state, and local money for public K through 12 together, it is not far off of the out-of-state tuition costs for Keene State. It's a ballpark figure. So the good news is that, generally speaking, the amount we spend on education is appropriately high priority, and we are capable of doing amazing. We're doing great things now. We're capable of being best in the country at around that figure. What I'm talking about, that's why I say it's small amounts of money. Some of this is policy. And to the extent it is small amounts of money, it is highly targeted in larger communities. That's where English as second language ends up being a button. In smaller communities, it's where special ed, and it's where this 108% cap comes in. These are targeted communities, but if you're one of them, it's a big deal. And I think, again, you want to have somebody that understands the impact at the local level of these sort of policies.
You mentioned the Keene State's out-of-state tuition. You worked for UNH.
Yes.
And you've done auditing of municipal, and I don't know if
school county, not schools so much, but a lot of departments.
But you're familiar with cost drivers on the public side. So why is New Hampshire's public higher education so expensive? And what is the governor going to do to help with student debt issues?
First, and it may be the way you phrase it, but one thing I would probably contest is that I don't think the our university system, I'm going to expand it to USNH, it is not more expensive than other states. In fact, I would argue that we deliver education on a per USNH student basis at a lower rate than a lot of other state university systems. But that's how much it costs. If the question is how much it costs the student, right? Because in terms of cost drivers, because I think there's a fallacy out there that it's, you know, literal ivory towers everywhere. There is an efficiency relative to their higher ed peers in New Hampshire, in part probably because of the force of the low spending. That's probably true. In terms of the impact on the student, the price tag, we do fund it at a lower level than virtually any state in the country. There is a slow trend line upward. And that's great, but there's no silver bullet. There's a number of silver BBs that I look at for how do you get students out of college with a degree that's impactful in the world of work and does not saddle them with large amounts of debt. That's a mission statement to me. I'll give you a practical example. When I worked at UNH, something that I spent a lot of time on is, you realize where there are holes in the economy in New Hampshire. That is to say, where is there a lack of supply of talent, but tremendous demand for said talent? Some of them you might guess, and some not so much. The one that you might guess is the classic software engineer example, okay? There are 100, at least at the time I left in 2014, at the time I left, there were roughly 100 open seats per year, so 400 total, for computer science, which generally is software engineering. The first year I was there, we had 38 kids graduating with a computer science degree at the University of New Hampshire. The biggest is, 38. I went to Liberty Mutual soon after I learned that figure. They have a Dover and a Portsmouth location, among others. Just those two locations, they asked me, could I get them 75 software engineers? That's what they needed. Even if I got every one of the kids graduating that May, that was barely half of what they needed. And I could identify over 1,000 openings just from the people I talked to in that first year I was at UNH. It's a crazy mismatch. Part of the reason for that is that we're losing students way before college age that don't even get to the point where they could choose software engineering as a degree. They're out of the game, particularly girls in this example. They outperform boys at the same age through much of middle school, and then there are a number of factors where they begin to generally peel off the track that would lead them towards a computer science degree. So we did two things, and again, that's the challenge. How do you deal with it? One, I, with a group of business people, started a what we called a smartphone tech camp, and it was very quick the first year because this stuff was hitting quick, and we basically did a pilot program with about 15 kids with 3 weeks' notice at Great Bay Community College, and the community college system, I think, is doing outstanding work and is keeping price tags flat. We had a female professor, because part of this is we want to communicate to young girls, This is totally a field for you. And I think role models are part of that. We had business people underwrite the cost of it, and it was $300 a person. If you couldn't afford it, that should not be a barrier. So the kids did it. They had 4 hours a day, 3 days a week for 7 weeks during the summer, a program where at the end of it, and then the TAs were younger employees of local technology firms that were helping underwrite any cost of the program. So Pixel Media, Bottom Line Technology, Bid to Win, and so forth. Kind of cool 28, 30 year old, that sort of thing. At the end of the 7 weeks, they developed a software app. We had a big presentation. Remarkable, the number of kids, including kids that were not A students in high school or middle school. They were C students in some cases, but they had a gift for this, and they were getting lost in the system because we weren't communicating how to maximize that gift. One of them, Bid to Win, ended up hiring one of the incoming ninth graders for $25 an hour for a couple hours a day, 2 days a week. That's how bad they needed talent and how good the kid was, by the way, at that age. There are thousands of kids like that in New Hampshire, but if we wait to begin building the relationship between even elementary school and middle school and high school talent, until after they're pretty much deciding where they're going to go to college, a bunch of things don't happen. Number one, they don't stay in state for college. We're building a relationship with an eighth grader that makes them realize going to UNH is a really good thing, or Keene, or anywhere in New Hampshire. They're building a relationship with the business. I want this to get to a point where then, when that student goes and gets a computer science degree at UNH, we build a program. And we began working on this, and it makes me excited to be governor because I feel like I could actually do this. If you estimate $25,000 a year for an in-state student, just a round figure, and 100 open positions a year, that's $2.5 million. I would, in addition to the state aid that would be done, an additional 1.25, that's half of the $2.5 million, that would be in effect a matching grant. Companies that are the ones telling me they need the talent would feed into that system. Up to $1.25 million. That's where the match comes in, for a total of $2.5 million. If up to 100 in-state students apply, and it's a rigorous test to get in, they qualify, you get in-state free tuition, because this is a priority major in this example. But you turn into a five-year program, so they have to do a Northeastern-style co-op, probably multiple 6 to 9 month co-ops while they're there. It's very good. And they have to do it with one of the participating companies that help chip in the private sector half. If they work for one of the participating employers after they graduate for a certain amount of time, they basically vest into it, one way of putting it. They don't have to pay back what would be the loan if they leave otherwise. What are we doing? We're building a relationship with UNH, in my example, relationship with the private sector in New Hampshire. We're letting students get out of school with no or virtually no debt. And we're helping them be ready for work on day one. The main companies tell me one of the main drivers of how they decide what colleges they most like to recruit from is they measure how long it takes that recruit from the moment they walk in for their first day of work and the moment that they see them as a fully engaged, profit-making member of the team. I've asked them which colleges. So Bryant College down in Rhode Island, that's where the Patriots do their training camp. That's how some people know them. Liberty loves recruiting from Bryant because they find that their graduates in less than 9 months or less are fully engaged members of the team. UNH was somewhere in the middle of the pack. University of Washington was really one of the best in the country. And then others were really low in the pack. That's how they measure this. So we can do this to make it not just better than average, but one of the best in the country at being ready for work on day one upon graduation.
Okay, so in your example, you're helping maybe up to 100 kids in a specific field.
Sure.
How many undergraduates are there at UNH? 18,000 somewhere?
I think it's a little less than that, but keep in mind that a couple things. One is, and I know there's another thing where the university system gets dinged, I think, unfairly. We have a decreasing number of high school seniors every year, so they have to get an incredibly high percentage of them that are college-bound to go to UNH or part of the university system just to stay even from the year before. They're going into this diminishing pool of in-state students. So you have to be very competitive. If you want to keep in-state students, the other candidates are saying it's really important, but they're not thinking specifically about how competitive you're going to have to be to take a college-bound in-state graduating high school senior and get them in. And there are certain fields like nursing, another one, public education.
So, but this is discussing programming and partnerships. How is this helping students with costs?
Well, they leave with no debt in these examples because it is as long as they remember it's paid, it's institution paid for, half of it private sector, and they leave not just incredibly ready to work in fields that are screaming for talent. They're doing it in New Hampshire, and they're doing it with no or virtually no college debt because they've completed a program that, as long as they keep their nose clean, work hard, you know, continue through the program, if they dropped out, you know, then they leave with no student debt.
And so that's in a specific field where you know there's a demand.
Sure.
Do you start funneling all the college academic programming into these specific fields where there's demand? Do you say, we're not going to have a program in history anymore, we're not going to have a program in French, we're not going to have a program in psychology, because right now the companies we can get to underwrite this type of partnership are looking for computer programmers?
This is not meant to be exclusive. There are a number of fields where you do this. What I would say, though, regardless of your major, technology is providing opportunities to lower cost as they walk into the door. So, for example, on a lot of your entry-level courses, think of your typical 100-level courses, which most, regardless of your major, most students are taking. You pay the same amount of tuition for that class as you would for a 500-level class, typically. Many of those courses, either through something like Program Running Start, or increasingly what you're finding are people looking at beginning at community college and to New Hampshire's credit, and there's another bipartisan opportunity. We're seeing this already going down the road. We have to look at lowering cost. I mean, do I want to increase funding? Sure, I do. But we've talked about a lot of things that I want to increase funding for, and I'm trying to be honest about the fact that I can't fund everything that I would like to do at the level that I would like to do it. So I have to prioritize where I can find savings that deliver better outcomes by focusing on the processes and opportunities, engagement of the private sector, with others where I think that opportunity is not there for other priorities that I think are really important. So with this one, some of it is you can use technology in order to do online courses. No, that is not a silver bullet. It's a silver BB. Can you do things with Project Running Start and encourage that further to get students getting college-level credit for high school courses in certain places? We do that. That's a plus. Community college, I love what's going on at the community college system. I know Ross Cattell, I think he's doing a great job. I think that's a bipartisan statement. People on both sides agree with that generally. And that you're seeing an increasing number of students that are able to get that first year or even 2 years of college done at the community college level. The credit costs are far lower, and the costs around it, room and board, are also far lower typically for students that do it that way. That's a fine way to do it, and we're finding across the country more students are doing it that way. But look, there are certain majors. We have to listen to the economy. I'm a liberal arts undergrad major. I got my MPA later, but I'm an undergrad. There's tremendous value to a liberal arts education. But when the economy is saying that there are certain places where there are tremendous lack of supply-demand curves, just not matching at all, I think that for economic growth in the future, we have to look for really smart, targeted, and what end up being in a multi-billion dollar budget, remarkably low dollar ways to better align the supply with the demand. And it is nursing, it is teaching, but it's also software engineering. There are other fields that are not so much. For example, mechanical engineering. The engineering school is where computer science is at UNH. Mechanical engineering is one where there are more students than there are seats. There's tremendous interest in that. That's great, but what we're finding is there is such a flood now that it's providing an equilibrium in supply and demand. That is not yet the case in computer science. So it's a dynamic thing. It'll change as the economy changes, and we need to be nimble as government, as academic leaders, to be able to recognize that and to make sure resources are matching it so we optimize what we have.
Okay. And as you said before, these days when you're trying to go all over the state are long ones, and I fear I've pushed that topic into driving us long, and I want to be able to let you get on with things. But I do have one more topic that I think we wouldn't want a gubernatorial candidate to go without answering or talking about, and that is energy. So the state, as well as New England, have extraordinarily high energy costs compared with us. I'm sure, as you talk with businesses, it's one of the things that they raise and over. You said you're against the Northern Pass for reasons we don't need to get into here, because it doesn't affect our part of the state as much as some others. But these big picture projects, we just had a pipeline proposal be withdrawn that had everybody in this neck of the woods up in arms, and part of the issue was, does the state have any say in citing that? So what are your feelings on what the state's role is or ought to be in terms of energy infrastructure, and what do you see as the direction that the state ought to be going in terms of finding energy?
One of the biggest elements to the subject that I think is not understood by members of the public is that we are part of a regional system, and that energy generated in New Hampshire is not energy consumed in New Hampshire. We do not live in a vacuum. We're only 10% of the energy market, the ISO New England energy market in New England. And so it means everything we talk about, whatever is done in New Hampshire, will generally have a relatively small impact on rates for ratepayers in New Hampshire, because we're a relative drop in the bucket regionally compared to, say, Mass or Connecticut. So I start with that. I am less worried in the near term about the number of megawatts generated in New England, and that gives me more confidence in saying, because folks will say, well, if you're not for Northern Pass, then what are you for, kind of thing. And remember, it's not a New Hampshire-centric question, it's a New England-centric question. And I'm not worried right now in terms of megawatts in New England. What I will say, though, in terms of a broader values, is a couple things. One is, I think the future is renewables. It's not the near future. I'm not suggesting, look, we're not going to replace 19% of America's electricity that's nuclear, and just, you can't just drop it tomorrow. It doesn't work like that. But in the long run, we need to be encouraging policy that moves us towards additional renewable. I think we're seeing that in solar. I think we're seeing that to a lesser extent in terms of wind. I think Maine has recently made some moves forward in terms of wind as a meaningful part of the mix. I think that the more diversity we have in our energy mix in New England, the healthier it'll be for our economy, because it will better avoid shocks in the economy that come when you over-rely on natural gas. I do worry that if we move towards an over-reliance on natural gas, which seems to be where the mix is going right now because of what we found not that far from here, it could put us in a position where if there are changes in that market, it could nail us in terms of rates here in New England. One other thing I think is that the best megawatt of electricity is the one we don't use. I go back to conservation. Firsthand, a couple of years ago, there's a program, you pay a small amount on your utility bill that goes towards, if you use an energy efficiency program, you can basically get a rebate for up to half of what you invest in terms of energy conservation. In our home, that would have been about between $9,000 and $10,000 bill, and we would not have been able to do that and didn't have that sitting around. By knocking it down to about $4,400 is what it ended up being, we were able to do an awful lot that has seen a really meaningful reduction in the amount of energy we consume in our household. I think that if you look at penny-wise and pound-wise, even wiser, continuing down the road, some of it's education. I think a lot of folks aren't aware that sort of program exists. Again, I look at very modest and targeted amounts of money that would allow folks that are interested to expand that program, because there is a finite amount every year that can be used in it. Conservation has to be a centerpiece, because in terms of the supply and demand curve, we control demand, theoretically, much more than we control supply, and as a small state. I can't make New Hampshire's rates lower unilaterally. It's a New England-based decision. We're a part of it. But to the extent that we can control how much we consume through conservation, as well as things like net metering, where we can get folks to be more independent in the way they generate, that is something we have relative control over. And so that's the attitude I take in policy.
I just want to squeeze one last question about guns, and obviously the topical issue now. So I was looking. You told the NHPR back in March that you supported concealed carry with permit, and that you would with permits, and you would support Maggie's plan to, or her veto of the bill that would have taken away permits. And then, but you also said in that interview that that you're not somebody who's looking to make big changes. Post Orlando and with the senatorial race dominated by this issue, do you have, I guess I'll just start slowly. I mean, so would you support AOT's current plan with the terror watch list and the selectee list? Do you think it should go further? And what do you think that New Hampshire should have stronger background check laws in general?
Okay, three quick things. One is I would support, I mean, AOT's plan. That's better than what we have now, but I would support what I guess you classify as a Democratic position on that. I have strong respect for civil liberties. I understand we need to do a better job of making sure that the watch list represents folks that should be on the watch list. That said, I don't think it's a linear thing. I don't think we have to wait for that to get better, given the compelling public safety interests. And so I think that we should do, I take the Democratic position that we should link should being on that list to not being able
to. So to contrast your position now, again, post Orlando, from what you did, the quote I think was close to in March, I don't foresee making any big changes to gun.
Well, I don't think it's a big change. I hate the term because it's become politically cliche. To me, that's pretty common sense. The other thing I think is common sense is expansion of background checks. You know, do you have the right, generally speaking, if you don't have a background that I think most folks agree would make you an inherent threat, you know, whether it's instability or some kind of criminal past, to have a gun? Yeah, but it doesn't mean you have the right to any gun or at any time in any place.
And one of the other perennial issues that comes up usually around issues of mass shootings, but not this time, is the issue of private sales and that sort of loophole, as it's so-called. If I'm interpreting what you're saying correctly, is that something that you would try to change? Doesn't sound like it is, but...
Well, no, I mean, you should not be able to purchase... I mean, you should close the loophole. You should have a background check, irrespective of whether you've purchased it at a...
So, with respect, these kind of sound like they are big changes. Closing the private gun show loophole and, you know, expanding background checks sounds like pretty big legislative, especially in this political climate where people are, people in the Republican Party are very strongly...
Well, I guess I'd say this. Over 80% of Americans, depending on what element of the policy you're talking about, almost 90%, including a majority of NRA members, I think feel the same way I do. So maybe it's semantics, but I don't think those are big changes. I think they're very common sense. It's almost a little bit like the way I look at the marijuana legalization issue. Some folks say that's it's an outlier issue relative to your opponents. That may be true within the context of my opponents, but I'm in the majority of New Hampshireites. I think these are common sense.
So Hassan has made this a big part of her campaign, obviously. Would you infuse that into either the remaining bits of your gubernatorial campaign, or if you were elected into your time in office? Would you carry the same passion that she is right now and that the party indeed is in general across the country?
I know it's their policies. I don't have passion, but their policies I'd advocate for. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a difference sometimes between policies that if they hit your desk, you might be willing to consider them. And maybe that's a subtle but important difference over, I would like this to get to my desk, if that's sort of what you're indicating. I would like this to get to my desk. I think these are pretty common sense. And again, I think that the people of New Hampshire, in this case, are generally ahead of where a lot of our elected officials, including even some in my own party, are on some of these issues. And that you have to be thoughtful, use data whenever you can, learn from experts whenever you can, but once you've reached that conclusion, I think you should be comfortable advocating for positions that match up with all the homework you've tried to do. And these are, and others are examples of that, and I hope that's indicative of how I try to lead on them.
Great. My last question will, is kind of that with this meeting.
I'm afraid I'm going to have to run.
Yeah.
All right. Appreciate it.
Pleasure meeting you.
Thank you. Same here. Thank you very much.
So I just one last question.
Okay.
So this is sort of like an editorial meeting, kind of, you know, probing your policy questions. I had more of a question about campaigning. You're up against two very state, you know, very capital-centered politicians. You mentioned this briefly in your opening remarks. How do you, you said it was going, is an advantage to have that local perspective, that local government perspective, and that's what you're going to bring to the race. But isn't it true that the other two, Van Oster and Connolly, you know, deputy state's attorney, executive counsel, don't they carry a lot of name recognition to begin with? And how are you going to combat that?
They don't.
Okay.
I mean, our name, 72% of likely Democratic primary voters, theoretically the most engaged people in this primary process, say they don't know enough about the three of us to have an opinion yet. And many of the other 28% aren't set in stone either, which can be both disconcerting as a candidate, but also it's a tremendous opportunity. If you have something to say and you work really hard and you run a really good campaign, I think people are looking for authenticity as much as anything. And when I'm on the trail and I'm working very hard and I'm out every day, one of the things I get back is I think folks see me as authentic. They see me as passionate. I speak and people talk. And I've tried to do the homework over a long period of time. And I think those are individual characteristics that give me the advantage when I have the opportunity to make the case relative to my opponents.
So you're not gonna end up having to go around campaigning in a Bruin 63 shirt and say, my cousin!
How I wish! One of my kids has a Marchand t-shirt, and that's about as far as we've gone with it. But it does help. I suppose it helps a little bit.
Okay.
Yeah. That should be the campaign tactic.
Yeah.
Is there anything that you were hoping we'd be asking about? Anything you wanted to talk to us about that
you covered a lot. No, that's pretty good. I don't think so. I think you got it.
All right. Well, then,
yeah.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.